this will never work. Of course it'll work. No. You take Meltdown, you dereference a hypervisor address, then you transiently read from it.
Yeah, but you know that the hypervisor's memory is not mapped into the virtual machine.
Functionals are everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coughing does the bidding bridge, your functionals for fun and for the prize, cause functionals are with us all the time.
Irene, on Claudio's test system, student code is run in virtual machines, right? Do you think Meltdown could work from within virtual machines?
So you run your own operating system or kernel then?
Yes.
And you attack the hypervisor?
Yes.
But how do you dereference the hypervisor memory then?
See, that's exactly what I told you.
From the kernel maybe?
Yeah, but you don't have a mapping of the hypervisor memory in the virtual machine.
Right. For Meltdown, we had a page where the user accessible bit was cleared. And if we access it, we got a fault, a CPU exception. But for the hypervisor memory, we don't get that.
Can we provoke that in some other way?
Well, you have plenty of bits in the page table entry, like present, writable, user accessible.
The present bit? If you set the bit to zero, it's ignored. And even then, the physical address in there, it's a guest physical address, not a host physical address.
Yeah. How do you know?
Well, I told him.
That's so unfair. Who is she? Or he? Or that person?
Well, you might know that person.
Wait, you can't just leave.
You're studying together.
Oh. Claudio, just tell me. I'll keep it a secret.
I can't. I promised. Well, I only promised I don't tell you the name. I can tell you the group number on the test system. It's 145.
Okay. You know that I can't look that up, right?
Yeah.
If the guest physical address is used, so they optimize for the regular path where the address is valid. So what if they just forward the bits from the page table before checking?
Why would they do that?
Well, it's faster. Let's look at paging in VR.
Yeah.
Let's say you run a program in your virtual machine.
Yes.
And the program then works on virtual addresses that are translated to
physical addresses.
But not those of the host, right?
Yeah. We call that part in the virtual machine, we call that guest. The virtual machine guest operating system. And so this would be guest virtual addresses in the program that are translated to guest physical addresses.
Right, using the regular four-level paging that we know.
Yes. And then these guest physical addresses are translated to host physical addresses.
Exactly.
So if I access a virtual address, the first thing that the CPU does is taking the CR3, which contains a physical address.
Guest physical address?
Guest physical address of the page map level 4 that is currently used in the guest.
Right.
Then we take the offset from the guest virtual address. We use it as an index into the guest page map level 4. And then we access that guest physical address.
Which means that the CPU internally resolves the guest physical address to the host physical address, and then accesses that host physical address.
Right, and so then we continue with the next level and repeat these steps again.
Down to the page, where you finally have the memory location you actually wanted to access.
Yeah, I remember that. I think we learned about that in cloud operating systems, and I think it's called extended page tables, EPTs. Without virtualization, you have four levels of paging, so you may perform 5 memory accesses, 4 levels, instead of 1 memory access that you would perform without any paging. But fortunately, we have TLBs, and TLBs buffer these lookups. Also the caches, the regular data caches, they buffer these lookups. So most of the time, there won't be any actual memory accesses, but only accesses to the fast caches for the address translation.
Mm. And here it would be even worse, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because we, for each level, we need 5. And so we would have 25 accesses in total.
That's right, yeah. But fortunately, the TLB saves us again, because it again caches those translations.
So if we set one of those mappings to not present,
then the guest virtual to guest physical mapping is invalid, but not the host mapping, right? You can't influence that.
Right. But here's where I think things might go wrong.
We'll see.
Yeah.
Guys, do you have any ideas who is behind group 145?
No.
Claudius test system?
But maybe we can try this attack I just came up with.
Which attack?
So you have a virtual machine,
mm-hmm.
and in the virtual machine guest, you set a mapping from guest virtual to guest physical, not present, but you fully control the guest physical address.
Okay, and then?
I'll try if the CPU uses the guest physical instead of the host physical address, which doesn't exist because it's not present,
mm-hmm.
to match the L1 tag and then return data.
And then we can check who is group 145 from Claudio's test system.
I see some noise. Meltdown didn't have much noise. And where does it come from?
Yeah, but noise is just someone else's data. What have you tried?
I take a page mapping,
mm-hmm.
and I write some physical address in there, but then I set it to not present.
And then you get an exception?
It seems to access the data then.
Do you have any second tool running?
What for?
I don't know. Sometimes with these micro-architectural attacks, it helps to have a second tool running as a victim. You know, like a dedicated victim program that produces some interrupts or that has some data in its cache.
Keeping the data in the cache. Why not? Meltdown was leaking from the L1. So for this, we would just need to keep it in the L1 the entire time. So now I have a program on the host that keeps one page loaded in the cache the entire time. Let's see what this does.
Did I miss anything?
Yeah, Lucas is trying to mount Meltdown from within a virtual machine.
Ooh, look at this. It leaks again.
Whoa. But where does this leak from? How does this work?
Let's check it out.
Sure, yeah. So you have a memory access, and the CPU sees I should dereference this address here and copy the value from there into this register here. So it starts with a virtual address and it looks it up in the L1 cache. That is virtually indexed.
But physically tagged.
Yeah, so then in parallel to the L1 lookup, the CPU gets the physical address from the TLB.
Okay, but the TLB doesn't have the physical address because the page table entry is not present and therefore it cannot be cached in the TLB.
But if the page table entry is not cached in the TLB, the CPU doesn't know anything about it, right?
Right, and that means it has to do a page walk. So it has to search the page table entry in memory and check the bits there.
So the CPU then has the page table entry ready exactly when the L1 lookup completes.
Yeah, and now think about what a CPU engineer would optimize for.
That the page walk was successful, and the address is valid, and the physical address from the page table can be used.
Right, but the entry is not valid. And that's already the case in the virtual machine guest.
So yeah, you're both right. The CPU has to raise an exception, but the exception is deferred. It doesn't happen immediately.
And here something super weird happens. So we take this guest physical address, and you're right, it shouldn't be used at all. But what if it's now interpreted not as a guest physical address, but as a host physical address?
That would explain what we're seeing.
So think about the tag comparison in the L1 cache. The tag comparison now uses the guest physical address and they match. And so the data is copied into a register. And at the same time, the exception comes in and in some form is added to the out of order execution pipeline, maybe as an operation in reorder buffer or however that works to flush the entire pipeline and everything. And then it runs the exception.
Yeah, so this is kind of a race condition, right?
Yeah. Like the ones we know from software, it's simply a bug.
Wow, this is huge. I will send an email to Intel right away.
No. I found it. I'll send the email. But give me a bit. I want to investigate this a bit more.
It looks like it still works without the victim pulling data into L1. It's just much slower and noisier.
Ah, you're leaking L's here.
Yeah.
And that makes sense, right? Because now you're essentially waiting for the data to be in the L1 by coincidence.
Can you try to run this off Claudio's home server?
The attack that they found here is called Foreshadow, and it was discovered by Jo van Bulk in late 2017 and reported to Intel in early 2018. And the difference between Meltdown and Foreshadow is basically, so in our categorization, Meltdown would be categorized as Meltdown US for the user space accessible bit, and Foreshadow as Meltdown P for the present bit. And if you think about it, for Meltdown, the classical Meltdown attack from user space, the operation in principle is meaningful. It just happens from a wrong privilege level. So what you have there is basically a deferred permission check. The permission check happens too late. For Foreshadow, this is different. For Foreshadow, this operation totally doesn't make any sense. There is some intermediate value, the guest physical address, which is used in ways in which it should never be used. So this is sort of the invalid use of intermediate values.
An important difference between Meltdown and Foreshadow comes from the respective root causes of these vulnerabilities. For Meltdown, the attacker selects data using a virtual address, and the user accessible check is not correctly performed during transient execution. This means that the attacker can control precisely, on a byte granularity, what to leak with the full 48-bit virtual address. For Foreshadow, the attacker selects data using a physical address, and the data is incorrectly forwarded during transient execution. This means the attacker can again control precisely on a byte granularity what to leak, but this time based on the 52-bit physical address. Both attacks can only leak from the L1 caches. For Meltdown, this was not a problem, as numerous prefetch gadgets can be found in operating system kernels that can pull arbitrary data through the direct physical map into the L1 cache for a subsequent Meltdown attack. For Foreshadow, this is also not a problem, as an attacker can also use prefetch gadgets in a hypervisor to pull arbitrary data into the L1 cache, but the number of gadgets in the hypervisor may be lower and the difficulty to utilize them may be higher. In contrast to Meltdown, where both the Meltdown attack and the prefetch gadget targeted the same virtual address, the Foreshadow attack itself uses a physical address, whereas the prefetch gadget in a hypervisor needs a virtual address valid in the hypervisor, such as the host's direct physical map. In conclusion, both attacks can leak arbitrary data from memory.
Thank you for sending me the code, but it's really slow.
Yeah, I could make it faster, but I really wanted to make sure I don't have any noise in there.
Mm-hmm.
And hey, I'm also skipping anything that's not alphanumeric.
See, that's a number. And
that's a name.
That's a name.
So yeah, so maybe they shouldn't be doing that.
This wouldn't be real student data. We just put some fake student data in there. And what we want to show to the viewers here is that the Foreshadow vulnerability is very severe, that it can really leak all the data. And I think it is important to show the impact of such an attack in an illustrative way.
So we just have to wait until we get the name. Okay, let's look at this. Okay, this is group 145 with the name C H A R.
What happened?
Oh, it disconnected.
Daniel, it works now. All the control logic is now inside SGX, so I restarted my server.
Okay.
Wait.
This might also work in SGX. Maybe we can leak SGX data with that.
What are you doing again?
So we can leak host data from within a virtual machine.
I'll try it with the physical address of the test system's SGX enclave.
An attacker can try to read the physical memory of an SGX enclave from the host system's kernel or a root-privileged process. This does not result in a fault, but it also does not return the SGX enclave's data. Instead, the attacker would just read a constant value of all ones. To provoke a similar effect as in the meltdown or foreshadow attack variants we've seen so far, the attacker resets the present bit of the corresponding PTE to zero. Now, accessing the SGX enclave's memory results in a fault. However, we have already seen that during transient execution, fault handling can be deferred and even incorrectly forward data. This is also the case here. Instead of going through the normal path, where real data was replaced with ones, now the attacker obtains the real enclave's data during transient execution. This breaks all confidentiality guarantees of SGX and allows an attacker to again leak arbitrary data, but this time from SGX enclaves.
Huh. Look at this, it still works.
So we can read everything from SGX as well.
Yeah, it looks like the L1 just takes the bits, interprets them as a physical address. And if that physical address is in the L1 cache, it doesn't matter if it's a host address or an SGX address, it just returns the data.
Wow. So that also means we can read all the host physical memory, is that right?
Pretty much. I'll send an email to Intel now.
And I'll shut this down until I have a batch for that.
Hmm. Wow, this will have a lot of impact.
Intel replied.
Really? Thank you for your report. The vulnerability you describe is tracked under CVE-2018-3615, CVE-2018-3620, and CVE-2018-3646, or the names L1 terminal fault, NL1TF, or foreshadow. 2018?
We should really start doing literature research before we start researching.
This patch against foreshadow focuses exactly on the virtual machine scenario.
So what does it do?
It flushes the L1 cache whenever you enter a virtual machine or exit a virtual machine. Yeah.
That's super slow and inefficient, right?
Yeah. But I mean, do you want those guys to be able to read all your student data? Probably not, right?
Yeah, maybe I need to get new hardware that has fixes against foreshadow.
But you have the patch?
Just enable the patch and that's it.
Maybe check the patch notes. I saw that there are some notes and you might have to configure some more things. But that should be it. Yeah, then it should be secure again.